What day is it today? It's Friday. What time is it right now? It is 2 p.m. So it is time to start our Friday forecasting talks. My name is Ivan, and we start our new term of season one of Friday forecasting talks with a presentation of Nikos Pavlidis on forecasting through adaptive combinations of large model pools. But before we do that, I'll just walk you through basic slides that I typically have about the center. So our center for marketing analytics and forecasting provides different services and works in different areas related to marketing analytics and to forecasting. You can see the team members on this slide. As you can see, we have 9 at the moment. And we have a variety of interests, including supply chain forecasting, machine learning, data mining, and so on. We plan to have 4 webinars in April, May. So this will be the last part of our Friday forecasting talks for this season. We will start with a presentation of Nikos Pavlidis today, and then we will go to Thomas Willeman, Michele Trovero from SAS, and Sven Kron. You can read more about these talks on our landing page. You can join our meetup group, or you can follow us on LinkedIn. Yeah, here is how you can keep in touch with us. We have Twitter, we have LinkedIn. You can send us emails and so on. So we plan to continue these events in autumn 2021 after we have these 4. If you want to present, send me an email. We're still coming up with the list of presenters for the next season. And that's it about the center. Let's move to the presentation of Nikos Pavlidis. Nikos is a senior lecturer in our department and a CMAF member.
Thank you, Ivan. Okay, so let's start then. The subject of today's presentation will be how to perform forecasting by using combinations of different forecasting models. This is a very well-researched topic, and I'm going to point to some major approaches in the literature. The emphasis in what I will be discussing today is how we can do that in an adaptive way. So this is in response to changes either in the model parameters and or in the optimal model. This is a work that I have done jointly with Alisa Yusupova, who is also a member of CMAF and a member of our department, and Themis Pavlidis, my brother, who is from economics. So let's just start by motivating what we will be studying. The question that we want to pose and to try to answer is, given a large potentially number of candidate models to forecast the time series, how can we optimally combine these to achieve the best forecast performance? Now, this is a very generic problem, and somebody can consider this to be a superset of model selection. So in model selection, we have a set of variables, and we want to find the subset of variables that is appropriate, depending on how this is defined. And you can come to that problem by saying, okay, given the set of models, I can create all possible, given the set of variables, excuse me, I can create all possible models with this set of variables, and then I need to find the optimal combination, but a combination that gives a weight of 1, basically to just 1 model. So the combination of models is a more general problem than model selection, at least in my perception. And therefore, it is a little bit more difficult to answer. When we try to address questions like this, one important issue that we need to clarify at the very beginning is what do we mean by optimal? So how do we define the optimal model, or how do we define the optimal criterion? Is it in terms of well-known criteria such as the mean squared error that is used when you assume typically that the environment is static? Are you considering point forecasts or density forecasts? If you are considering density forecasts, there is wealth of methods that try to minimize the Kullback library divergence between the true model that gives rise to the data and the combined model that you are producing. Are you in a forecasting environment where you are mainly interested in minimizing one step ahead or k step ahead forecast error? And all of the and this decision, I think, is very, very important into how to identify the best way to combine the models that you have at your disposal. More recently, and by saying that, I mean in the past 10 or 12 years, at least in the econometrics literature, there is a big discussion about combining density forecasts. So the forecasters, instead of just providing a point estimate for the next time step, they provide an estimate of the entire distribution. And that is judged to be very important in certain application areas, how to optimize the distance, right, or the divergence between the combined density forecast and then the true density, which we don't see. Another important distinction is whether we assume that the individual models that we are trying to combine are given exogenously. So somebody provides you with a pool of forecasts and then you need to find the optimal combination, or is this also part of the estimation problem that you're trying to solve? Is it up to us to estimate the individual forecast and then also the strategy that combines them? Another important question is, what do you assume about the data generating process? Is it static? So, and in that case, the typical assumption is that data is IID. Or is it possible that there are changes or structural breaks in the data generating process? This is also sometimes summarized in the word dynamic environment. And depending on the answers to these kinds of questions, the approach that somebody needs to take will, of course, change. And we will discuss in this presentation a particular instantiation of this problem. Now, before I go and talk about the work that we have been doing, I think it is important to recognize that this type of problem has a very, very long history. I think some of the earliest references go back to 1969, and it's possible that there is work even before that on this problem. And it is encountered not exactly the same, but under different variations or under different sets of assumptions in very diverse literature. So the first bullet point here is in the econometrics slash statistics literature. I think it is a bit difficult to distinguish between these two areas, at least for me. So I think one of the seminal papers in this is a paper by Bates and Granger that appeared in 1969 that first discussed how to optimally combine forecasts using a mean squared error as an optimized criterion. There is a lot of work, of course, on criteria such as Bayesian and dynamic moving average that are more close to what we will be describing today, where, again, we have a very large pool of models and we have mechanisms that incrementally update the weights that your combination is assigning to the different models. Then there is this very rapidly developing literature in density combination that started off with a paper by Hall and Mitchell in 2007. And there are also some machine learning approaches that have started being applied there that relate to shrinkage, so methods like ridge regression, lasso, and so on. So these are, I hope, a brief overview of some of the main trends in the literature that appears in econometrics and statistics journals primarily. But this problem has been very much studied in the context of machine learning as well. One important reference is stacking. This is a method proposed by Brayman in 1996, which deals exactly with this problem of combining forecasts. Then there is a very large literature that is called Prediction with Expert Advice, which started in 1992. More recently, there is work in artificial intelligence, I would say more in the side of computer science, that considers neural networks or other more advanced structures such as convolutional neural networks to combine models. And I think that one can even consider this problem to be once as as an instantiation of a change detection problem. Right? So if the optimal combination changes over time, then you can formulate this as a change detection problem and try to identify the points at which this structural change occurs. And then once you have that, you can easily identify the optimal weights within subsegments. So there is a lot of thought, and there's a lot of research that has been devoted to this problem. And of course, all of these different works employ different sets of assumptions, right? And thus they consider slightly or quite different instances of this problem amongst themselves. Now, the main characteristics of the approach that I will be discussing is, first of all, we are interested in estimating the individual forecast models and combining them. We do not assume that the forecasts, wherever they are, whether they are point forecasts or density forecasts, are exogenous to our environment. We want to control that, and we want to have accurate estimation. And we also discuss the combination stage. So that's the first thing. The second characteristic is that we are interested in applications where the candidate number of models is very large. And if we want to use the capital K to denote the number of models and capital T to denote the duration of the time series, we are interested in cases where the number of models can be orders of magnitude bigger than the number of time steps. We, at least in this work, we assume that we don't really have a lot of prior knowledge about what are the appropriate models, so we can't really trim down K to a manageable set. And we also assume, and this makes sense actually from our application point of view, that both the parameters of the model and the optimal model changes over time. So we are not interested in approaches, or as I will show in a little bit, approaches that assume that these are static are limited for what we want to do. And the last point is that we would like to retain the interpretability of the output of our method, both in terms of individual models, but also in terms of the model combination algorithm. So I will briefly now outline the solution that we propose to address this and try to justify why we think that this is a sensible approach. So I'm first going to talk about the model estimation phase and then the model combination phase. So each model, so in our case, is a dynamic linear model. This is also known as a Kalman filter. And such models are described by the two equations that you see in this slide. If we look at the second equation, so the second line here, this is a very familiar linear regression. Right? So the variable that we want to estimate y is a linear combination. X are the predictors, right? The exogenous variables, so lagged values of y and so on. And theta are the parameters of our linear model. And there is, of course, some noise, and we make the standard assumption that this noise then follows a normal distribution. So this is a standard linear regression. The only thing that changes in this context is that the parameters of this linear regression evolve over time, and in particular, we assume that this evolution follows a random walk. So the parameters in the previous, at the current time step are equal to the parameters in the previous time steps plus some Gaussian noise. And the reason that we assume Gaussianity both for the first equation and the first equation is known as the state-space transition equation, and the second one is the observation equation, is because this allows us basically to use the Kalman filter, and we can perform updates computationally efficiently, and therefore this is feasible when we have a very large number of time series. So this is what we assume, right? We assume a simple linear model. Each model in our pool of models is a linear model, but the coefficients of that linear model are allowed to evolve over time through this random walk model, which is actually quite flexible and allows us to adapt in response to different types of change, gradual change in the coefficients, as this shows, but as I will show in a moment, it also allows us to adapt very quickly to structural change as well. So there is a lot of work, of course, on nonlinear modeling, but we find that linear models are surprisingly effective in practice. We understand them very well, and they allow us to perform uncertainty quantification. So we can create prediction intervals, confidence intervals, and all of that, right? And they are also computationally cheap. So we think that this is a reasonable trade-off between accuracy and feasibility, if you like. Okay, so this is what we assume for all our lowercase k models that we will have in our pool. Of course, in practice, we don't know much about the parameters of each model. We don't know the thetas. We also don't know the variances in these two equations. The first one, the sigma squared underscore t, so the variance in the observation equation or measurement, that's not a problem. We can estimate that very easily from the data, from the observations that we have. The difficult quantity to estimate is the variance covariance matrix for the state space transition equation. Okay, so this W here. There are, of course, ways to do that proposed in the literature, but they are computationally expensive. So what we instead propose to do is to use a dynamic linear model with forgetting or discounting. This is a model that has been very widely used. It appears in many textbooks on dynamic linear models. And in effect, what this does is it involves a scalar parameter, which is known as the discount or forgetting factor, that takes values between 0 and 1. And this parameter basically controls the trade-off between stability. So when lambda is 1, we assume that basically the data generating process is completely static. And as lambda decreases, we allow the speed of this random walk process for the coefficients to become faster and faster, if you like. Or we, in a different way of saying this is that this W matrix, we inflate this W matrix by this parameter. So this is a very simple approach, right? It completely alleviates the need to estimate this unknown parameter W, which is quite difficult, especially when you have high dimensions. In other words, when your model involves a lot of variables. And this results in just using a single scalar parameter lambda. But the problem with that is that how well your model is able to predict the observed time series depends quite heavily on an appropriate choice for that parameter. So typically the way that this is done is that the user selects this parameter, which is usually a high value, higher than 0.9, and then the dynamic linear model operates, and that's it. Now, in order to try to overcome this limitation, we basically propose a way that tries to optimize the value of this parameter over time. So after you observe each observation, you update lambda so that you improve your forecast error, right? Your forecast become more and more accurate. And the way that this is done is we frame this as an optimization problem. We say that the optimal value of this scalar parameter is the one that will minimize the forecast error, and specifically the expected value of the forecast error. So depending on the value of this lambda, this affects the estimated coefficients. The dependence is quite complicated, so I chose not to represent it here. But if you look at the equations of the Kalman filter or the dynamic linear model, this is very clear. So the choice of this parameter affects these estimated coefficients, and the estimated coefficients, of course, affect the forecast error. So we would have liked to select the value of this parameter so as to achieve the minimum expected error. And this expectation is with respect to the pairs of X and Y. Okay, at least in my point of view, this is a sensible objective since we are trying to optimize forecast performance. The problem with this objective is that the equation that we want to optimize this expectation here is not available in closed form. So we don't have a formula for that. And that makes solving this problem quite practically infeasible. However, what we do observe every time that we make a forecast, right, we observe the actual error, right? So this is the difference between the observed value of y and the predicted value for the particular value of x that we have. And we can, in fact, use this observed error, forecast error, right, which is different, of course, from the expectation. But we can use this single observation to develop an algorithm to tune this value of lambda and, in fact, to try to achieve this optimality constraint. This is a field of optimization called stochastic optimization or stochastic approximation, and it deals exactly with this type of problem. So you have a function that you don't observe its expected value. Instead of that, you observe noisy realizations of this function. And from these noisy realizations, you design algorithms to optimize, whether that's maximize or minimize, the expected value that you are interested in. And this is a very active area. This has been a very active area in the past, and it now has become again extremely active, in my opinion, because a lot of research in very large neural networks requires methods that are computationally efficient, like the ones from this literature. So I will not present exact formulas for how the updates work or not. I will just show you a simple example. The material for this is available on archive. If you are interested, you can access this. So what we have in this example is we have a process in which we have a five-dimensional regression problem, right? And the coefficients for the linear regression change five times. There are five regimes. So the actual values of the five coefficients are shown on the right-hand side with solid lines, and you see that at distinct change points, the values change abruptly. Right? And with a dotted line, we see the median estimated coefficients, and the interqual time range is shown with the color around the median. So these are the five estimated coefficients, and you see that the first change point, for instance, is at time step 100, the second one is 400, the fourth one at 700, and so on. And what you see is that the proposed adaptive scheme works in the sense that the estimated parameters, right, respond quickly after each change point, and they tend to find the real value after a certain number of time steps. So this is what we see on the right-hand side of this figure. On the left-hand side, we see how the parameter lambda that we are trying to tune responds to these changes. And in effect, what we see here is that whenever there is a change, this is associated with a very sharp decrease of this parameter, which means that our model is discarding past information very heavily. And once the estimated parameters converge to the observed, to the true values, the forgetting factor, this discounting factor, increases, and in the limit approaches one, which basically says that our model now tries to put equal weight to previous observations, which is what we would exactly like to see, because that allows us to improve the estimation accuracy for our coefficients. So this is one example where we see that this approach of trying to tune lambda through this stochastic optimization approach works and makes sense, and it responds to in the way that we would expect. And another interesting feature of this is that for this specific example, where instead of the coefficients changing gradually, we have abrupt changes, there is not one fixed value of lambda that is optimal. Right? So you would want lambda to decrease very rapidly once a change has happened, and then you would want it to take the value of one so that the variance of the estimated coefficients becomes small fast. Okay, so this is an outline of how we are trying to handle the problem of developing accurate and flexible models to predict the time series of interest. The second aspect that I want to discuss is how do we combine them. The approach that we are going to use in this work is one from the literature on online learning in the machine learning domain. This is also known as prediction with expert advice. So in this literature, the forecasts themselves are considered exogenous. So somebody provides you with a pool of forecasters. You don't have control over them. Okay. And the problem that you're trying to deal with is the following. On every time step, you are asked to predict the next value of the observed series. And you do that through a weighted combination of the forecasts provided to you by those experts. So the first step of the algorithm is that you generate this forecast, and these weights always add up to one. So this is a convex combination of the experts' predictions. After that, you observe the actual time series value, the actual y. And once you observe that, you go back and you update the weights, these WTKs here, of each expert in the pool. And the idea is, of course, that this update depends on how accurate the given expert is at each time step. So experts whose accuracy or loss in the language of this domain is small, of course, their weights are increased, and experts whose loss is large, their weights, they are downweighted. Okay. So this is the very simple outline of the problem that is we are trying to solve. And our objective here is to try to minimize how poorly our combination algorithm performs compared either to the best expert over the entire time series length or to the best sequence of experts. So this notion in this literature is called regret. So regret is defined in this case like this. This is you sum over all the time periods that you have. This is the loss of your algorithm. So however you want to measure this, in our case, we are measuring forecast error. So this is the observed y minus the forecast y squared. Okay. And then you want to have a very small difference between the best forecast of the time series. If we break this time series into M segments and we choose the best expert within each of these M segments. Okay. So this is what this literature is trying to come up with, is to basically clever ways of updating these weights so that this quantity here is as small as possible. And of course, what we don't know here is we don't know how many segments the time series is actually broken into, and we don't know when the change points come. Where are they located in this? So this is an ambitious goal to begin with. This is a very difficult problem to solve. An interesting aspect of this literature is that there is absolutely no assumption on the time series YT itself, or many methods don't involve these assumptions. And a lot of the methods in the literature also don't impose any assumptions on how the individual forecasters are generating their predictions. So this is assumed to be externally given. What they do assume is they make assumptions about what is the shape or what is the type of this loss function. So it can be, for instance, convex, it can be bounded, and so on. And for our case, the really important assumption is that this loss function is bounded. The vast majority of literature in this area assumes that this loss is within some interval, either 0, 1 or something like that. And the proofs that the algorithms will achieve the best possible regret and so on really depend on this assumption. This is not easy to realize. There is some work very recently in this direction, and I will not go into that in detail. I will just mention that the algorithm that we use, which is called ConfHedge, was first proposed in 2017 and more recently published in machine learning in 2019, is, to the best of my knowledge, the first algorithm that has a known bound on this regret quantity here when the loss function is unbounded. And this is really important for us because, if you recall, we assume that the errors on each dynamic linear model are normally distributed. So the error can be, so y hat can be anywhere between minus and plus infinity in theory. And also what is really interesting is that the results that they prove in this domain handle the finite time horizon case. So we have known bounds for a finite value of t, and we, unlike a lot of work in classical statistics that has takes an asymptotic viewpoint, right? It discusses cases where t goes to infinity. So this is the model combination algorithm that we will use, and a really nice feature of that algorithm is that there are absolutely no user-defined parameters. You don't have to choose anything. All the parameters of the algorithm are handled endogenously. Now, I will first show a very simple example of model combination when the optimal model changes over time, and we will use that as like a sanity check, and then we are going to see performance on real data, which is always much more difficult to understand because we don't know what the ground truth is in those cases. So we will consider a very small instance of our problem, so we will not have a very large case. We will only have three models, and each one of these models is basically an AR1 model, an autoregressive model of order one. These are the model specifications, and the noise terms are Gaussian, so this fits with the assumptions that we had before. And the only thing that is challenging in this case is that the optimal model changes every 100 time steps. So for the first 100 time steps, the optimal model is model one, then it's model two, and then in the last segment, it's model three. Now, we consider a number of combination methods like Bayesian moving average, model averaging, dynamic model averaging, and more advanced methods from density combination. The last two are very, very recent, like density combination and Bayesian predictive synthesis. And this is what the results look like. On the left hand side, we see the evolution of the estimated weights for each of these three models over time. And on the right hand side, we see the mean squared error, in, the one step ahead squared error, forecast error. Now, I will not go into a lot of detail. The only thing that I wanted to show really here is that, let's magnify this a little bit. So if you look at methods like Bayesian moving averaging and actually dynamic moving averaging as well, with a very high value of this forgetting factor there, they are very, they very quickly identify the optimal model in the first time step because there is no parameter uncertainty here. So these methods are perfectly suitable to find that immediately, and they do. But after the change points, they don't really respond. The only method out of this family that responds is this dynamic model averaging with a low forgetting factor, but even then there is a considerable delay. And interestingly, after the second change point, the response is completely wrong. So instead of shifting all the way to model three, it shifts it back to model one. Some other methods like optimal prediction pools, this is a method proposed by Hall and Mitchell and further developed by Gewicki and Amisano. They assume a static environment. So of course, they are not really designed to perform well here. They immediately spot the correct model in the first segment, but then they respond very, very slowly. As we can see. And again, they have a big problem with the, after the second change point. So instead of shifting the weight to one, they shift all the weight actually to the second model, which is not right. But what we also see is that more recent methods, we don't show here Bayesian predictive synthesis for technical reasons, because the weights don't add up to one, so it doesn't make sense here. But Deco, whose weights do, right, has particularly strange behavior. So although this method is extremely effective in terms of the mean squared error, it performs very, very well in terms of forecast error, excuse me. When you look at the interpretation of the weights, it's difficult to understand what's going on. And the final, our algorithm is this dotted purple line, and we see that it performs reasonably well. It adjusts the weights slowly, and the reason for that is that it only takes into account the point forecast, not the density forecast overall. And it is also being very, very conservative, right? Because it assumes that there can be changes in the optimal expert, so weights are not adapted very, very rapidly. But what you see is that it gradually increases the weight of the correct model each time, right? And in the limit, it assigns a model a weight of one to that model. And it is actually the model combination method that handles best the second change point. Okay, so that's a little bit the intuition behind why we recommend this. And now the inevitable table, I hope. Just a very quick point, computational times, that's actually quite important. So if you use methods like Bayesian or dynamic model averaging, they are really fast because they are designed to update weights incrementally. If you try to consider density combination methods, the cost increases substantially. So these are computational times, median times in terms of seconds. So these methods, including ConfH, require something 10 to the minus 3 seconds for each experiment. If you look at optimal pools, the computational time is about 7 seconds. But if you go to more advanced methods like DECO or BPS, we are talking about, I think DECO, the median time for DECO is 6.4 hours, and for BPS it's more than 13 hours. So if you want to use model combination methods that use densities and they also account for time variation, because these methods use MCMC in the case of BPS and particle filters in the case of DECO, the computational time can become quite high. By the way, these are with the default settings proposed by the authors. Of course, they can be changed, so you can speed them up, but that would be at the cost of performance. So that's just a simple illustration of what we were trying to do. Then I will just now talk a little bit about the actual real-world application that we considered. We are trying to predict the UK regional housing market, so we have quarterly seasonally adjusted data. They span the period from 1992 to 2017. We have a set of 11 variables overall. We don't have a lot of prior knowledge about what is the optimal model specification in different regions, and our results actually show that this is different in different locations in the UK. Four of these predictors relate to regional characteristics, and seven relate to national. So what we do here is we basically consider every possible model that we can create given these variables, which depending on the region can be between thousands or tens of thousands of models, whereas our time series length is 143, if I remember correctly. So I apologize for this. I know that every presentation must come to a point that there is a long table that it's difficult to read. What this table very briefly says, we consider here the benchmark model AR1. This is considered a very appropriate benchmark, a difficult to beat benchmark in real estate markets. Our model is what we call adaptive model combinations. This is in the second form, and we have DECO with the default parameter settings from the authors, Bayesian predictive synthesis. This is the optimal prediction pools method of Hall and Mitchell, and then different versions of DMA and BMA. And what we basically show is that our method always is better than this AR1 benchmark. So this is the dot. The star shows that it is statistically better than Bayesian moving average, so the static parameter selection. The circle indicates that it's better than a competing version of DMA, this one, and the dagger says that it is better than DECO, which is out of these three density combination methods performs the best. Now, I have to be clear, we were unable to run, of course, DECO, BPS, and optimal prediction pools with 30,000 models, given that it takes so long to run when there are only three. So we had to select the five candidate models to give as inputs to these density combination methods, and the specification of these models is reported in this slide if you're interested. We tried to provide five simple models similar to the spirit of the papers where these methods were proposed. So this is, if you like, summary findings. If you want to look at the results a little bit more closely, some interesting findings from our research is that basically the optimal model over time changes and is also different across different regions. If you have a region where the real estate market exhibits high volatility, then this is picked up by our model. So if you look at the weights assigned to different variables, for instance, as we do here on the left-hand side, this is for Northern Ireland, you see that there are certain variables such as this house price uncertainty index that appears to be relatively less important, and then suddenly there is a very big spike. This is following the 2007 financial crisis. Then in 2010, there is another one, whereas other variables such as the consumer credit index, I think, also changes in different directions. So this is a volatile, if you like, housing market. If you look at a much more stable housing market, such as the one in the Northwest, then you see that variable importance is much more static over time, although there are still some changes. Okay, so this is a brief overview of our work. The conclusions of this would be that model combination, despite the very long research into this area, remains an interesting problem, at least for us. We think that it is worthwhile to consider both aspects of the model combination, both individual models and how they are combined. We are interested in developing tools where interpretability is important, both in the models themselves but also in the combinations, and we would like to, we're interested in working in problems where we can adapt both the models but also the combinations incrementally and at a relatively reasonable cost, even when the pool of candidate models is very, very large. In my view, there is a lot of work in machine learning and specifically in this area of prediction with expert advice, which to the best of my knowledge has not been very much investigated in the forecasting literature, and I think this is an opportunity. This is all that I have to say, so thank you very much for your time. I guess I can stop sharing now.
Thank you, Nikos. Great. So I've asked Simon Spavound from PIC, he's a data science team lead in PIC, to sort of provide his overview to the same topic and maybe ask a question to Nikos or something like that. So Simon, over to you. You can, yeah, go ahead.
Cheers. Thank you, Ivan. First, thanks, Nikos, a very interesting talk. The first thing I'll say is I think I agree that there's a lot of work been done in some of these machine learning areas that's not been applied yet to the forecasting literature. So I think there's a lot of work to be done there. I was just a bit curious about the, on one of the graphs you showed, the forgetting parameter returning towards one, because obviously returning towards one would imply using all of the data from all time, or equally weighting all data from all time. How, I'm thinking about a very practical example with, for instance, this COVID crisis that we've all been living through for the last year. Like, at some point, presumably that data is, let's hopefully never have another pandemic again. From a philosophical point of view, we may want to exclude that data forever, whereas here we would always include that.
No, we wouldn't actually, because once those data have received at some point in the past, right, a very low forgetting factor, they will never return to that, right?
Okay.
So when it goes to one, this means that every new point that you observe now is given a weight of one. And of course, if the forgetting factor decreases again, this will be lost again.
Okay.
So you don't go back. So you are working in a completely incremental fashion. You don't go back to set that value of the forgetting factor to the whole history. You're just looking at each point in time.
Okay. And the other point I just wanted to say, because obviously I agree that the AR one is a very difficult one to beat in this context. I was just wondering if you'd compared it against just simply averaging across all of the very large combination, you know, the very large number of models that you're considering.
Yeah, so this is a really interesting point. Yes, we have. Really, averaging, just simply averaging, works actually better than what all the methods that I have shown here. And the reason for that is, of course, that the time series is short and you have a very, very large amounts of data. So if you are in situations like that, then yes, beating the average is an extremely different, difficult objective. We are working on this, but this is not something that I have discussed here. There is a very nice paper, if you're interested in this, in the 2019 International Journal of Forecasting by Diebold, and I'm sorry, I forget the name of the second author, that talks about shrinkage methods that incorporate this issue.
Cool, thank you.
Okay. Right, good. Thanks, Simon, for your questions. Thanks, Nikos, for replying. Now we have several questions from the audience. I will rephrase some of them. So, for example, the first question: in forecasting, we typically don't care about causality. So why would we care about interpretability of a linear model?
I have a different opinion to that. So I guess it depends on what is your starting point. I think that I think that in a lot of applications, causality is really important. Of course, we shouldn't confuse causality with correlation here. But
Okay. Yes. Well, this was a bit nasty question, I would say, because I also don't agree that causality is not important in forecasting. But that's okay. Fine. Thanks. What do you assume in terms of the initialization of each model?
So that really depends on how you want to initialize your dynamic linear model. You can do it, I guess, in different ways. Here, I initialize all the models with coefficients of zero.
Uh-huh. Okay.
But, you know, of course, if you have a better prior, that would be, of course, appropriate in that case. And that doesn't affect in any way what I have discussed.
Okay, good. Right. A comment, but maybe you can also say what you think about that. For particle filters, a GPU implementation could yield a couple of orders of magnitude speed up. So this would...
Yes, that is a very good point. And for those of you that are interested in this, so there is a MATLAB package for the method density combination deco, which, as I said, it's a MATLAB package, so that means you have to have a license. But it provides a parallel implementation that uses GPUs. You can use a GPU parallel computation for that method. For Bayesian predictive synthesis, because this is an MCMC algorithm, it's not parallelizable, at least as far as I know. I think that when you are trying to compare computational times, you should use, if you like, a common benchmark. So you can't have one algorithm being executed on a CPU and another one executed on a GPU. If I may say also one practical aspect, which of course may not interest our audience, we are not allowed to run MATLAB parallel in our cluster here in Lancaster University. So I was unable to do that at all. So I cannot report this time.
Yeah, interesting. I didn't know that we have this restriction.
This is only for MATLAB, but anyway.
Yeah, yes. Last comment that I see, is it okay to be unable to interpret why a certain size of weight is assigned to a particular model?
Okay, so there is some literature that says that that's not a problem. So, and certainly, we can do that. If you assume, for instance, that all your forecasts are biased, right, then you would benefit from having an intercept right in the model combination. And that is also work that says that the coefficients don't really have to add up to one and so on. I'm not saying that this is an absolute necessity, far from it. From my point of view, and especially when you designed, for instance, very simple examples like the ones that I showed, it is reassuring to know that your algorithm, right, manages to do something sensible. Let me make one last point. This requires a little bit more discussion, and we don't think we have the time, but if you consider, for instance, a linear model, right, to combine these forecasts to predict the examples that I showed, then there are basically infinite ways of predicting the observed y in these different time segments. So if you just look at the plots of the coefficients, they basically tell you nothing. Okay, and I personally would like to know which models are involved and so on.
Mm-hmm. I think Robert wants to ask something.
Yes, possibly based on a misinterpretation, but you said, I agree that selection is a special case of combination. But the nature of the weighting scheme, does that permit you to essentially simplify the group of models, the overall set of models that you consider?
Yes, so this is a very interesting point. And as I said, I didn't discuss shrinkage methods. I had this actually in my conclusions, and now I regret removing it. We didn't talk about this. I don't think we had time, to be honest. This is a really interesting problem in itself, and this is something that we are working on currently. I think that if you're interested in this, the reference that I provided in the 2019 edition of IJF is a very good starting point to look into that. I personally find it a very nice paper.
Mm-hmm. There is a long comment, and I will shorten it to the question. Have you looked at controlling the estimation uncertainty of the combination weights? How does this interact with the forgetting factor, if you did?
No, we haven't looked at that. I think it's because the contents are... So we are using an established algorithm for machine learning. We don't have a contribution there. And this, all the theoretical properties of this algorithm are established under the assumption that the forecasters are exogenously given. So this is an algorithm that tries, given the quality of the forecast, right, to predict as accurately as possible a changing sequence of best forecasters. Now, of course, if the models themselves, right, change characteristics, then the optimal solution or what confidence will do will of course change, right? So if you have a model that is able to track the best forecast over time, then this is a static model combination problem. If all of your models are very poor, right, even if you use the best model to predict it, then your predictions will be terrible. That is one of the reasons why I say that I think it is more valuable or more interesting to consider both sides of the prediction problem, both the individual models themselves and the model combination aspect of it.
Mm-hmm. We don't have any more questions from the audience, so I will ask a question actually to both Nikos and Simon, because I know Simon also worked a little bit in the area of dynamic linear models. So what do you think? We see that there are examples of application in, for example, real estate and economics. Are these methods usable in supply chain and demand forecasting? What is your view on that? Nikos, maybe you can start.
I don't see why not, let me put it like that. I think they are a very general form of modeling that can accommodate a lot of different characteristics. So if you think that in an area you can use a linear model, then definitely you can also use a dynamic linear model. Which one will perform best, if this is the second or the follow-up question, will really depend on how well you set up your dynamic linear model, I would say. And of course, the characteristics of the process itself.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And Simon, your view?
Yep, I would agree. Most supply chains, you can apply these kind of linear models. There's clearly a philosophical question about whether the model specification is changing in this way. And I sort of alluded to this in the COVID discussion of, you know, the demand for toilet paper over the last 2 years has probably undergone rapid changes in its parameters, we could say. So yeah, that's my kind of feeling on this. There is and obviously, as Ivan and people who saw my previous talk in this series, there's clearly a strong demand for interpretability. I think the sort of push for interpretability is an important one, particularly in those kind of contexts where demand planners are trying to understand, you know, what factors are important and that kind of thing. So I think this Again, I agree with Nikos's previous comments on the causality point being an important point.
Right. Well, and final small question from me as a follow-up from this. As far as I can see from my communications with companies, they don't use these methods. So what do you think is the main obstacle in the application? Nikos, maybe you can start.
I think generally speaking, people use methods that they are comfortable and familiar with. So a lot of it depends on who are the people that are working for these companies, what is their background, and how well they understand different methodologies. This is my approach. Depending on the kind of algorithm you can have, for instance, for a neural network, right? You can have somebody that is really good at training them and using them, and they can make them work in an application, whereas somebody that has very little experience and perhaps little patience will not do as well in doing that. And so I think the real answer to this is this one. I think that over time, as people are getting more and more trained in such kind of methodologies, these methodologies will become more mainstream. And similarly, as software becomes more and more available in different packages or products or whatnot, these methodologies will also become more widely used. But I remember I heard from somebody that the big success of the Kalman filter was when it was used in the Apollo mission to go to the moon. So it's not exactly that it's not being used, right? I mean,
yeah, fair enough. And Simon?
Yeah, again, complete agreement. I mean, there is a common expression of like, when you have a hammer, every problem is a nail. So people often use the methodologies they're familiar with, regardless of applicability. Just on this point as well, some of these methods, again, I was very glad to see in Nikos's presentation a discussion of computational time, because particularly for practitioners, this is a kind of an important and under sort of appreciated fact that for practical applications, you know, for the examples we were talking about here with 300 time observations, if it's taking you 7 hours to produce a forecast there, it's not particularly useful. So there's clearly a, you know, for practical use, companies are going to want methods which can be quickly applied, both in practitioners being able to use the methods quickly, and also then the computational time and complexity that goes along with that. So,
Right. Thank you both. Thanks everyone for attending this talk. It is time for us to finish. See you all in 2 weeks. We will have a presentation by Thomas Willimon.
Oh, hello.
Yes, and thanks everyone. Thank you, Nikos. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, Nikos. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.